Welcome back. I am Courtney Levette.
DJ Crazy, and we got a special guest in the building. Yeah. Everybody make some noise. Nick Love in the building. Hey, Nick. Let me let you know something off top now.
Okay. Don't even start. Don't even fucking start, yo. Don't even make the statement. Just don't even make the statement. He's so petty.
We had smoke in here. Smoke feel my oven.
I just don't like people being all in.
Oh, she went crazy. No.
What?
That's not what he did.
Why did he do that? He did a lot.
It was really extra. It was very...
You doing like Harvey Weinstein extra or like
you touching me too much, bro. I don't know you.
Okay. Well,
and I told him he didn't have my back because he kept letting the man just, you know, do a lot. Okay.
He was caressing you.
It was a Me Too moment. It was a hashtag Me Too moment.
He was shooting his shot. So
when was this? This before the New Year, after New Year?
It was before New Year.
Oh yeah, you can't shoot your shot in December. That's not cool.
Wait, why not?
January is shoot your shot month.
Why? Like, I thought it was August.
December, you got to wrap it up.
Wait a minute. Hold on.
If you didn't have it prior to.
Yeah. So the end of the year is like, yeah, no. But it's not August. So August is not cuffing.
December is purging. January is when you start.
Hey, this is my first time ever here.
I've never heard that ever in life. It's a definitive timeline of this.
You can't be out here. Yeah.
Guys, don't shoot your shot in December. Shoot your shot in January. January is the year out. But February is right after that. Then you got to do Valentine's Day.
Yeah, I mean, you got to be cautious when you shoot a shot in January, though, because you'll end up with a date on Valentine's, and then you got to get gifts, and it's weird. So if you shoot your shot in January, just know.
You got to do Valentine's Day, too.
I can't agree with you on that, though, Nick, because January, they know that income tax coming around, so they stuck up then.
But see, that's only if she ain't got a real job.
Come on now, stop.
So you ain't waiting on your income tax right now?
No.
Shit, I'm waiting on mine.
Oh, you got a kid? You got a kid right now too? Actually, I'm waiting on two lawsuits to come through.
But if that's the game you playing, you absolutely got to do Valentine's Day because you can't. Yeah. You have to do Valentine's Day in order to get the income tax money. You have to play that game. You got to play the long game.
If you ever dated this guy, ladies, I'm sorry.
You got to invest in that.
You're right. You got to invest in it.
Yeah, you got to play the long game for income tax.
All right, so real quick, man, for the people who don't know who Nick Love is, tell them because my dog posted, he posted on Facebook and was like, you know, Crazy C got Nick Love on the podcast for y'all artists that don't know. And niggas really hit my inbox like, yo, who is Nick Love?
Man. So. That's cool. You know, I'm going to tell you something cool about that. So, all right, I'm Nick Love. I do some of everything. I do marketing, management, consulting. I'm a food, you know, enthusiast, strip club connoisseur, Atlanta ambassador. I do some of everything. I mean, I would really be here for a minute trying to tell everybody what I do. Mm-hmm. So it's almost better that y'all just ask me some questions and then y'all be like, damn, he do that too? Oh, shit, he do that too? Oh, wow, he was in that too?
So let's start off with we had the Jeezy Gucci Icy situation.
Right, so I started with Jeezy back in 2002. Mm-hmm. So I've been around, I was the VP of marketing for CTE for 8 years. So I was with Jeezy from Streets Is Watching, Trap or Die, TM101, the USDA album, you know, the inspiration, you know, I was around for all of that. So I kind of seen that from the beginning. Shout out to my boy Fi Chief in here.
Yeah, so you know the young Fi Chief.
Yeah, I know the reckless young Fi Chief, yeah, you know what I'm saying? So I've been around for that, and, you know, I was instrumental in really boosting his career, so.
Okay, you know, so while we're on that subject, was Icy, Jeezy, and Gucci biggest record? Well, you said that was what made him mainstream, right?
I said I think it was a mainstream song.
Oh, now she changed it, that made Gucci mainstream.
Gucci, I think Gucci's biggest wrestler had to be Wasted.
Okay,
hands down, he was fresh out of jail. The first time,
in case y'all didn't,
all time high. He came with a hit record. Mm-hmm. I don't think he really had hit records before then. So Icy is a nigga hit. Right.
You think?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I guess if he knows.
Wasted is like MTV, TRL, YouTube, you know, numbers. Right. Like, Wasted was a huge record. Huge.
I agree.
Huge. And Plies was hot at the time. Plies was on fire when that record came out. So it was like, that was a big deal. Yeah.
I don't like saying that I'm wrong and stuff. So
but Icy was a dope
so
record.
So I'm going to just say that I'm right.
Icy was an incredible introduction record.
For, not you know, Lemonade. What about Lemonade?
Lemonade is probably my favorite Gucci record, but mind you.
No.
Okay, hold on. I'm going to say this. I mean, mind you, I was with Jeezy for years, so I had an inherent bias against Gucci. I didn't fuck with Gucci for years.
Mm-hmm.
Just wasn't a fan. Just wasn't even tuned in to that. Like, nah, I'm over here. That's over there. I don't fuck with it. But Lemonade was like, all right, I fuck with that.
You had
Lemonade was a smash. Wow. Banging Dash did his thing on that. That was really? A smash record. Yeah.
I mean, it was a good record.
I mean, and it was the first time that I was like, okay, like he really put that together. Production wise, lyrics wise, from having a catchy hook.
That
worked.
That was probably the most trash Gucci record.
Wow. What?
No, I mean Gucci record. Wow. Man, listen. I mean that's a trash record too. But Gucci made Gucci made a lot of trash records.
Well, no.
The Usher
Gucci
record
has an abundance of trash records.
And the Gucci time.
A lot.
Yeah. I feel like
he dropped a lot since he's been out too.
And that's not even me being biased. Mm. Gucci has a lot of bad music out.
I just like Gucci, man. I'm not even gonna argue because I'm biased. See, I'm biased, so I'm not gonna argue
I wouldn't even call myself a fan, but I appreciate what he do.
Yeah,
but he got a lot of trash.
I feel like I like him more so because it's culture. It's for the culture.
No, I mean, I tell you.
I like Gucci because he's for the culture, and I just.
But you know what though? When I used to be in Central Station though, fucking I'm a dog. Fucking some of them Gucci records that was out at that time. Shirt off.
Yeah, shirt off is
off and get a party going.
Shirt off is like it's like, lit.
Gucci got a few records, but I'm a dog and shirt off. I remember being in Central Station being like,
I'm so glad they closed that damn place. Yikes. I'm so glad that place is closed.
It's so crazy. I DJ Mainland Macon, and I forgot all about these Gucci records because I can't play them.
Absolutely.
The niggas gotta get the shooting.
Like, people don't understand that was a real thing. Like, you couldn't go to Macon playing Gucci records, like, at all. Like, not a one.
Shit.
Like, you taking a real risk out here. Yeah, like, a real risk.
Yeah, that's why I stayed at 20.
Like, yeah, that was a legit beef.
All
right, so let's get off of everybody else's stuff and let's talk about.
What you think the biggest records you've been instrumental in?
The biggest record? Man. I mean, for me, I don't have a big record that I was.
Well, that's
not true. Cashing Out, we did the cash, you know, for Cash Out. Cashing Out was big. But we jump started, you know, I managed the Coalition DJs for 8 years, you know what I'm saying? So, with all the, people who don't know Coalition DJs, that was all strip club DJs here in Atlanta. So, I started that back in 07. So, actually, the 10-year anniversary of Coalition is actually this week coming up, January 15th to the 22nd.
So, you started that all together?
Yeah,
that
me and DJ Big X. So, we started out with four guys, Big X, Funky, DJ Big X, Funky, X-Rated, and Nando, rest in peace. We started that, so us five created the Coalition DJs. But we started off the Future Movement. You know what I'm saying? Right. So everything from, the Dirty Sprite project that X-Rated did and just kind of from there. Future's whole play.
I want to say this, and I don't want to seem like the hater, but Coalition been hanging on to that Future project for hey, it's been, it's been like, 10 years now?
I'm going to tell you about that. I'm glad you brought that up. Okay, so, what I'm saying? I left Coalition December of 2015, and I just came back recently for the 10-year anniversary. But one thing as a marketing person, because I'm a marketing person by trade, like the management stuff is everything, and the A&R and everything I used to be an artist. I wanted to be Nate Dogg. I thought singing and cursing at the same time was like the most amazing shit in life. What? I heard Regulate. I was like, no.
I want to do that.
I thought Nate Dogg was a genius.
And it worked.
Yeah.
And it worked.
But I'm a marketing guy by trade. But one thing about marketing and any artist, DJ, anybody that's doing anything creative, the number one rule for, promoting a project is to have a story. Mm. And you have to have something to attach, what you do to. Hell, we black. All of us got a little bit of talent.
Right.
Everybody in here can sing, dance, rap, beatbox, beat on the table.
You want to hear me sing?
I'm sure you can pull it off.
Don't do it. Please.
Okay. We'll wait until when we go off.
But, think about it. Every female that loves a Beyonce or whatever, I'm sure everybody like, I got a cousin that can sing.
Yeah,
I'm a homeboy. My homeboy rap.
That's
true. Know what I'm saying? Like, we all kind of got the homeboy, the friend that can do a little something. But
so
it takes something
words,
to kind of turn you up.
Are you saying that you were the missing piece to turn Coalition back up?
Well, it's not even a missing piece. It's okay. There was a time in Atlanta where you had to go to the strip clubs to break records.
Right.
It was undeniable. You had to be there. And if you weren't in the strip clubs breaking the records, especially from the street side, you didn't have a shot.
Right.
It was how I got to the radio. It was how I got to the real tastemakers. It was how I got to the real A&Rs. I think now with Spotify and Apple Music and
Instagram,
YouTube and social media, like you don't necessarily need that pipeline. I feel like it's important because you need that foundation in the streets. You want people to be able to connect a record to you. I mean, think about how many songs have come out lately that you know the song, but you have no idea who the artist is.
Right.
Like, I do an event at Escobar at 2 Chainz restaurant called Name That Tune. And so we play all these new records, and it'd be a crowd full of people, and everybody know the record. But when it comes time to name the artist,
they
like,
don't know.
Gucci Gang is my guilty pleasure record. I love that fucking song.
And it was on Snapchat.
I know who does it.
It was on Snapchat. But that's what's crazy.
90% of the people in the restaurant had no idea who the hell Lil Pump was. But they know Gucci they Gang, know. Gucci Gang, Gucci Gang. Like,
and that, it's like, and that song is dope.
You know, it's a dope song. It's a scary thing, man. But you know, in building coalition, we had to attach a story to something. So once you have a success story, and I'll say this, partly it's not even our fault. I mean, you know how long it took me to shake that Nick Love was the Jeezy guy? Like, it took a while. It took me doing Bite Life. It took me doing Coalition. It took Future. It took all this stuff to become Nick. I was Nick Love with Jeezy for years. Mm. Right. And I was like, but I've done 10,000 other things. Mm. But I couldn't shake the stigma of I was CTE.
You shaked it now?
Yeah, I think I've shaken it. Yeah, I mean, you know, I don't mind doing interviews and talking about it. But, I mean, I think it took me a while to shake it. Like, I know people. I was on Twitter the other day. I'm telling somebody. I know people who only know me for the food shit. And that's amazing.
That's
to me.
Good, though.
You know what I'm saying? I started doing Bite Life in like 2013 to 2014, something like that. Mm. And so when I meet people that's like, oh, yeah, you're the food guy, I'm like, that's hilarious to me because.
Can we talk about that, though?
The strip club guy or the
can we talk
guy,
about the food
the
stuff?
I knew like, nothing what? About the food until I Googled it because like, I Googled just to see what I could find.
Right.
Little tidbit beefs or something like that.
Right.
And I seen it. It was so funny. I was like, dang. Him and Lady V gonna vibe because you know, shout out Lady V.
She's our chef.
We got our own chef in here. She's right. Doing shit for us. Yeah. But I was like, this nigga do food.
Yeah.
How did you even start? All right,
so in like 2013, I'm 37 years old. I've been doing music since I was 19.
Damn, bro,
I've been in the music business in Atlanta since I was 19. I started with DJ Toomp and Dallas Austin and all these guys before I ever got to Jeezy. Right. That's how I got to Jeezy because I was working other stuff.
Right.
And I started working with Jeezy when I was 22 years old. You know what I'm saying? Like, I remember being 19, 20 years old and thinking, one day, I'm going to run the marketing for a label. I got the job at 22 years old. I didn't
even. Not thinking it was going to happen that fast.
No, I mean, I met Kinky B on a complete fluke. Me and Kink hit it off, and then there I was.
Mm-hmm.
But 2013, I just was bent out of shape. I was like, I'm tired of the egos, tired of the personality. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, you deal with, you know, just dealing with artists, producers, and just, you know, this is a cutthroat business.
Yeah.
And it takes a lot to, you know, it takes a certain temperament to deal with the stuff that you deal with. So I've just kind of been out of shape. But I made a lot of money, you know, doing what I did. Mm-hmm. So, but I realized the one thing that I really spent money on was food. I was never a Louis Gucci guy. I was never a sneakerhead. I was never in the old school cars. I didn't want to rebuild no engines, you know what I'm saying? Like, but when I made money, I didn't mind spending $100 at lunch. You know what I'm saying? And
that's the one thing I'm going to spend my money on is this.
Right. And keep in mind, like, me and my wife, I was married at the time. I split with my wife in, like, 2011. So, at that point, I'm dating. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking for spots to go and figure out where to go. And you can't take a girl to Old Charlie's but so many times. You know what I'm saying? How many times you going to go to IHOP? You know what I'm saying?
I mean, those are great places.
Those are not great. Okay,
I mean, those are really good places to eat.
Amazing.
I like Old Charlie's.
Old Charlie's has Olive top five bread in the game.
Olive Garden, yeah. I'm sorry.
Olive Garden,
Old
Charlie's.
Sorry. And I don't even like bread.
I don't like Red Lobster, but the Red Lobster
them
bread is solid.
Them cheddar biscuits.
It's
a cheddar biscuit.
But Old Charlie's is a top five bread in the restaurant, for sure.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I just was into food, so I just started kind of exploring. So I would go out. You know, if you can eat burgers and fries forever, you just like, all right, cool, whatever's out there. So I would just hop around. So I'd ride past a restaurant and be like, oh, what's that? And so what happened is I got on social media. I was on Facebook, you know, with friends from school. I'm from Decatur. I'm from the east side. So I realized when I was posting that I was at a restaurant, a lot of my friends had never left Decatur.
Mm.
So they like, where's that? I'm like, what are y'all you talking about?
Go to 85,
they like, where's that? I'm like, y'all don't know what that is? So I just kind of started putting them on. Mm-hmm. And so then I kind of accidentally became the guy that everybody's like, well, my anniversary coming up, my birthday coming up, my girl thing coming up, where can I take her? And I knew all the spots. So it just kind of, you know, just kind of fell in my lap. And then I just started taking the rappers with me. So if you go on YouTube, you'll see me out with 2 Chainz, with Jeezy, with, you know, just different artists going out to eat at different restaurants, just trying stuff out.
Okay,
and it just stuck.
That's dope. That's dope.
And I know you mentioned 2 Chainz a couple of times. What you got going on at Escobar right now?
Escobar is kind of headquarters for me now, man. On Monday nights, I do a thing called Mix Show Monday. So, you know, me, my girl Day, shout out to her, shout out to P. Brown, DJ Cutthroat, this is my people. We do a thing called Mix Show Monday.
Let me say this right, because you shout out to P. Brown. So, P. Brown, your people, can you get P. Brown here? Because me and P. Brown had a war on Instagram the other day.
Oh, no.
I'm glad you said
that. About what?
First off, let me ask you this. How do you feel about the younger artists? Well, not the younger artists. Independent artists going to these strip clubs, performing on the open mics at the strip clubs.
How do I feel about it? I don't feel no way. I have no opinion. No, I don't think so. I think anytime as a new artist you can get in front of people, I think it's a benefit to it.
Oh, that's the political
age. No, that's real. No, I agree.
I'm gonna tell you why I
see too many artists here and perform.
Absolutely.
Come on.
Okay,
but why would you not perform anytime you have an opportunity to perform?
I come from a school of thought that you should try to get a fan a day. I've always believed in that. So if you can come in here and perform, and somebody who didn't know you knows you all of a sudden, you just never know. Because I've sat in plenty of rooms and like bullshit open mics, but I'm me. And not to say, not to toot my own horn, but if I'm in the crowd and I think you're dope, I might mention you to DJ so-and-so. Right. I might mention you to label X or label Y or whatever the case may be. So I could actually change your life to a certain degree. Yeah. So you don't know who you're performing in front of. I think what I disagree with is the open mics where you're just performing in front of other artists. I don't like that.
At the strip club.
But no, if you at the strip club, it's not just artists there.
No, I ain't talking about.
But I've been to plenty of open mics where it was just rappers performing for rappers.
That's kind of stupid.
This is my thing. And you're so right about this. When I think about the strip club performance, when I think about, Blue Flame, so-and-so Thursday open mic, you're going to get 25, 30 artists that just all they really want to say is they performing at Blue Flame. Mm-hmm. So then you're going to get a couple of us niggas that want to see ass. And when we come in there, we got to deal with this goddamn trash and music. Half of it ain't music.
Oh,
so
God.
A lot of it is trash. So now we got to deal with that. While we just came, we really came to see ass. We came to strip club.
Can we mix and master first,
where would you prefer
please?
Them be? Where would you prefer them perform at?
You find a quality.
There's Apache Cafe. I mean, it's Atlanta. There's a million venues you can perform at.
I do think. I said about Coalition. Mm-hmm. But I do think the New Music Monday is effective.
Absolutely.
Because you in front of a lot of DJs, a lot of tastemakers. Mm-hmm. I do think you need to find events like that to perform at.
I agree.
Opposed to just the strip club open mics. No. I put that on Instagram. P. Brown came at my neck.
Damn.
Like I'm talking about, she came at my neck. And I just told her she can come here and we can talk about it. Because I feel like it's pointless. If he in the strip club right now, he's not wanting to see not one independent artist.
No, he's not.
What if he likes the song though?
Yeah.
So now you've now gained
the other thing.
But you still have to gain a fit. It doesn't matter where you perform. You can perform on the side of the street.
I came to see pussy and ass.
I don't want
to
be the fan you gained.
Listen, I came.
Oh my God. See, you like, no.
That was hilarious.
Listen.
That was great.
Yeah, like, so if the stripper's like the dance, the song, like.
Guess what? And this is my thing. If you think about the number. Listen, if you think about the number and percentage of artists that go through these clubs, even if I go for one night for 3 hours, I'm going to have to listen to 30 to 40 niggas
rap. It's atrocious.
That's a bad night
to go. It sucks. Look at what day you going to the strip club if you don't want to hear it.
Can't go to Atlanta.
From what society and social media said, I can go to Atlanta. Goddamn, JD told me, in 98, I can go to the strip club Monday through Sunday.
Absolutely.
In Atlanta and have a good time,
for sure.
Right?
You're still going to have a good time because it's going to be naked ass in your face.
I'm listening to rappers.
Right.
You know, and half the time, the bitches don't like the songs.
Okay, you got a point about that. But I mean, here's one thing I've learned over the years. Remember, the Migos weren't always the Migos. Jeezy wasn't always Jeezy. Future wasn't always Future. At some point, Future was the guy at the open mic.
We talking about guys who had great relationships. Goddamn, Nick, if you grab me and made me a rapper right now, I'm a blow.
You got a shot. I'll tell you that.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
So go to the Migos. The Migos had that network.
But you still got to put in the work to get to where you are to have a network.
You don't just wake up with a network all the time. You still got to put the work in.
The artists don't always got to. I'm telling you, Nick can make you the motherfucking most poppinest female in Atlanta right now.
Can I have a Cardi B year?
Hey, listen.
I can have a Cardi B year. I want a Cardi B year.
Self goddamn jump Cardi B.
Speaking of which, first of all, Cardi B did have an amazing year. But you know, people keep overlooking my man who had a better year than Cardi.
Who?
LeVar Ball had a better year.
I like him.
LeVar Ball.
He's a great parent. He's a great parent.
I mean, much love to Cardi. I think what she did was amazing in 2017. I hope she can repeat it.
But you know, they
LeVar Ball
just
had a hell of a year.
Yeah.
He's still going.
You okay with him sending his kids overseas?
Fuck yeah.
I mean, I am. I agree. I just like to hear other people's opinion.
I mean, it's questionable. I don't think, you know, there's no precedent for what he's doing.
Yeah.
But
why is it questionable though?
I mean, because no one's ever done it before. Yeah. So you gotta. There's a little bit of skepticism you gotta have about it because it's like.
No, he's just a parent.
In most people's opinions, if that was a viable thing to do, we would have done it before, right?
But
so he's the first one.
Nobody else has been in that situation.
Everybody's just uncomfortable, and they're trying to treat his kids like they're his kids.
You're gonna see everybody do it.
Everybody,
I think it's amazing.
LeBron gonna do it. Hey, LeBron gonna do the same thing with his sons.
And I think I think if he had a different type of temperament and a different type of personality, I think it'd be easier to digest. I think he's so abrasive. He's so black. He's very black.
He's so black. He's very black. He's the typical black man.
And
he's talking that shit too to everybody, and it's working.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, you know, I firmly believe that when you got the hottest hand, like you have to like throw all the chips in the middle of the table, and like he has it, and he's throwing it all in the middle, and I think people are very uncomfortable with. I think they want him to play it safe, like try to.
Yeah.
Easing it, you know, put his toe in the water. He dove into 12 feet.
Right.
And everybody's like, oh, shit, he's swimming.
So, I was just going to say,
like, what I've always said about LeVar Ball is he's that parent in the stands.
Yeah.
That's cussing out the other team and they players. He just want we working out today. Thank you. No, he's just that parent in the stands. So it's just like, why is everybody mad at him for wanting his kids to be great?
Here's the difference between LeVar Ball and the parent that's cussing out the people in the stands. You know, cussing out people in the stands. Typically, if your child is LeBron, you don't have to curse nobody out because everybody in the crowd knows what it is. Right. So that parent doesn't usually fall back. The parent that's cussing people out has the child who's pretty good but not or terrible.
Yeah,
LeVar got.
Got the LeBron.
Got the kids that are solid, and he's still cussing people out.
Maybe I would be.
So it almost seems unnecessary.
I guess.
Yeah,
I think I would be.
I think what he's doing is amazing, though. And like I said, and it's amazing because he's right.
Mm-hmm.
If he was wrong, we just think he was a dumbass.
Yeah.
But because he's right, when you're right, everything makes sense.
Yeah.
You can and you can do that from the music career. I mean, you know, I worked with Jeezy for years, and you know what I'm saying, and he knows it because I've said it to him. But when you're right and you're hot. You can say and do pretty much anything you want. You can not show up to shit. You can show up to shit late. Mm-hmm. You can be a complete asshole when you hot.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, but when you not.
So.
You know what I'm saying? Then everybody you should have known and you was late for and you was an asshole too. Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to entertain it anymore because it's like, oh, well, we don't need you now. You know what I'm saying? So, again, you know, just kind of you playing. You know, like the day that when his son stopped working, when one of them gets hurt or they really not balling, then it's gonna turn.
But he should have a brand to fall back on then.
Maybe, you know, but I think the brand right now is on a shaky foundation. His sons have to ball. If they don't ball, we're gonna laugh at them. Right. Not we. I'm gonna fuck with them, but the masses will laugh.
I really feel like you shouldn't even.
Like if them other two kids that went to Lithuania like end up in the league from Lithuania,
what can you say?
They're gonna call him a genius. Mm-hmm. If they end up stuck in Lithuania. Everybody gonna say, "See, we told you, dumbass."
One of them is gonna be the younger one.
Yeah.
Everybody say the younger one.
Yeah.
Nah. But yeah, the older brother hustler. But listen, we gotta go.
Yeah, I don't want to hold y'all
up
all day.
We got a few things, but before we go, I got one question to ask you.
Uh oh. What's this?
Is Jeezy washed or not?
Is Jeezy washed or not?
You gotta think that means he washed. He's definitely washed right now.
Okay. Yeah. 2018. Yeah, he washed.
You agree?
He's washed. Yeah,
see, exactly, man. I tell people all this.
I mean, I just had to think if I wanted to go on record with that. Yeah, he washed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So
he's an icon. I mean, he's a legend. He'll forever be what he is. But yes, I mean, I think his time is
new ventures.
His time is past.
It's time for new ventures.
I mean, he has new ventures. I don't think he even needs the music to catapult all the stuff. But just I think leave the music. He's washed. I think his time for. I think he's washed.
All right, so. Tell the people what you got going on a weekly basis. Monday we at Escobar.
Tuesday we at Escobar now.
Okay.
Thursday and Friday we at Hookah Hideaway. So Hookah Hideaway is a spot off of Auburn Avenue. But Thursdays I'm about to really kind of do something with that with a lot of independent artists. So it's not going to be going to the strip club no more. But I really want me personally, I like breaking new artists. So I want to give them a platform, and I think they need it. You know, I think all artists need a platform. I think if they're good enough, you know, they'll shine through, and you can't stick them at any and everything. So I'm with you on that. I want to go strip clubs to your ass myself.
Right.
Bite Life is taking off. We're doing some stuff I can't really speak on too tough, but yeah, the food thing is really popping. So follow the Bite Life, TheBiteLife. So a lot of people think I'm saying bike like motorcycles, but it's bite like biting food.
Like bite.
Okay. Yeah. So the Bite Life, and then just follow me, man. I'm doing some of everything. I want to be as involved in the Atlanta scene. Musically, politically, socially, as I can. So I'm born and raised here, so I'm a big proponent of seeing this city work. So,
hey man, shout out Nick Love in the building. Hey.
Shout out to me. How y'all feel? This is a big deal.
We got a mayor named Keisha.
We got a mayor named. We got a mayor named.
We got Keisha. A mayor named Keisha.
And we had a mayor named Kasim.
We got a Kwanzaa Hall. Like, come on, Atlanta. Yeah. So Atlanta. But
Atlanta
no.
Black. Like I say, I'm 37. I've never had a white mayor in my lifetime. Hey,
it's like it's lit here. So yeah. You know, don't move here listen. Though. Don't move y'all here because we full as fuck.
Listen,
but.
I'm 37 years old. I've only seen one championship in my lifetime. Come on, Braves.
Good. All right, you guys follow.
And
Nick
I've never
Love.
Had a white mayor. So,
follow
I mean.
Nick Love on all social media. Please.
Hey, shout out to the Braves, man. It's Crazy Talk Podcast. Nick Love in the building.
We'll
we got
be right
more
back, man.
Yeah,
yep.
That's it, man.